حين الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا وسيئات اعمالنا، من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له، اشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله وسلم عليه تسليما كثيرا الى يوم الدين. ثم اما بعد، dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this is the last Jumu'ah in the month of Ramadan, and we are bidding farewell to our beloved guest, the month of Ramadan. And inshallah, we'll see another Ramadan in the next year if we leave that land. So, with the uniqueness of the month of Ramadan, the uniqueness of the religion of Islam, with the uniqueness of the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the uniqueness of the Laylatul Qadr, the uniqueness of the Quran, the uniqueness of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is an indicative from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we Muslims, each and every one of us, has to be special, has to be unique, and has to be exceptional. Do not be like most people, do not be like the majority. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the majority in the Quran in a derogatory manner, in a disgraceful way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Most of them don't use the reason. وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Most of them don't know. وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Most of them are disobedient. So do not be like the 98% of people. Do not be like them. Do not talk like they talk. Do not go where they go. Do not specialize in what they specialize in. Do not go where they go. Do not be like them. If you want to be exceptional, do not fit in and you expect to be exceptional. That's impossible. So Ramadan is a challenge. And they say, what challenges you, changes you. Whatever challenges you, change. Whatever challenges us, change us. Change us. So Ramadan has to be a challenge for us. Ramadan gives us, has to be a challenge for us by the lessons that he gave us. There are so many lessons, but unfortunately so many Muslims as well are heedless about these lessons, or are heedless of these lessons. And they say, they think that Ramadan is about suhoor, fasting, breaking the fast, taraweeh, and repeat. Or sometimes they say, no, taraweeh, Ramadan, the purpose of Ramadan is to have this empathy for, or to feel the poor and the needy and the starving person. But that's wrong. The reality is, you can never feel what the starving person feels. Because at the end of the day, you'll be having iftar. You'll be having beautiful iftar, mashallah, different types of food. While the starving person can find a little if he finds. So Ramadan also is the month of patience. Ramadan fosters immense patience in us. By fasting from the Fajr to Maghrib, also by dedicating some hours to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the night by performing Taraweeh. MashaAllah, we see so many Muslims, يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ, they hasten to do good, hasten to open their mushaf, hasten to the masjid, you see the masajid, mashallah, full with the musallim, you see people giving charity, giving zakah, doing all the good deeds, alhamdulillah. But what some people don't understand is that they expect people to do the same thing in Shawwal as they do in Ramadan. Now, after Ramadan, within a day or two, we see some people filming, taking their cell phones is filming the masajid. Oh, where are the people? Where are those worshippers of Ramadan? And in fact, there is nobody who worships the month of Ramadan. But Ramadan is a special month. We have to understand this. Ramadan is a special month. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it special. Laylatul Qadr is in Ramadan. The doors of Jannah are open in Ramadan. The gates of the doors of Jahannam are closed in Ramadan. The shayateen are chained up. So there is no way where you can say, where are the people? Why can't they be the same as they were in Ramadan? That's impossible. We understand that the a'mal, the iman will decrease. That's normal. But we don't mean that to call off everything. You leave your Quran, you leave the masjid, you leave sadaqah. No, keep up the good work. أحب الأعمال إلى الله أقلها أدومها وأقلها. But the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are these deeds done in constant. These deeds are done regularly. Although if they were later, these are the most beloved deeds to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So by saying the iman will decrease, it doesn't mean that you have to leave everything now. Even if you read half juz' a day, it's okay. Few pages from the Quran is okay. Half page, it's okay. But keep it up every day on a daily basis. Keep up giving the charity, keep up doing the good work. So also Ramadan teaches us the self-discipline. And when it comes to when we talk about discipline, we think that discipline is a big thing, is a big matter. Now, if you want to understand and you want to learn discipline or self-discipline, you have to go to the universities. But self-discipline begins at the small details in your life, such as making your bed after you wake up. That's self-discipline. Such as putting your shoes in the shoe rack. That's self-discipline. Such as washing your hand after using the toilet. That's self-discipline. Self-discipline starts with small details that we neglect in our life. So Ramadan gives us self-discipline also to guard our mouth, to guard our words, despite being provoked. And this has to be our methodology, not only in the month of Ramadan, but also throughout or in our life, in our entire life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the most exclusive servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Furqan. When he said, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلْ أَرْضِ هُنَا. He mentioned the qualities or the attributes of the exclusive servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, عباد الرحمن, the exclusive servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are those who walk on earth with humility. وَإِذَا خَطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. And when the foolish person addressed them, they respond with peaceful words. These are, and there are so many other qualities. So Ramadan also comes to detox and to cleanse our body. We've been filling our stomach in the whole year. So Ramadan comes to detox and to cleanse our body. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مَلَأَ آدَمِيٌ وِعَاءً شَرٌ لِبَطْنٍ. But no man feels a container worse than his stomach. Again, no man feels a container worse than his stomach. And if you pay attention, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this hadith before 1,400 years or 1,500 years. And he said, no man feels a container worse than his stomach. At that time, the food was fresh. Was little, but fresh. At that time, the food was locally sourced. At that time, food was natural. At that time, the food was healthy in the pinnacle of its healthiness. Despite that, he said, despite all of that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no man feels a container worse than his stomach. So what about our time? When we have more corporate, manipulated, controlled food by the companies or the industries of food, the food has become less healthy. Why? Because the Prophet is paramount. Our food is being manipulated, controlled. We have, as they call, refined grains, refined oils. Until we, you know, that means, you know, when we say that the Prophet is paramount, the Prophet is their main concern, that means corner after corner after corner had to be cut from our food till we get the cheapest possible product with the highest possible prices. To plus all sorts of low quality food, all sorts of processed food is advertised and promoted as a meal food. Deception. Wallahi, it's deception. Well, they advertise and promote, no, it's a meal food, but it is a processed food, genetically modified food. I'm not saying that all the genetically modified food is bad, but most of it is bad. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مَا مَلَأَ آدَمِيُّ مِعَاءً شَرًّا مِنْ بَطْنِهِ, that no man feels a container worse than his stomach. Now we are filling our stomachs with pizzas, junk food, sugar, sugary beverages, energy drinks, soft drinks, I call it soft drinks, food prepared with hydrogenated oil. They said they call it a vegetable oil, or seed oil. Yeah, we know it was extracted from seeds. It was extracted from vegetables, but it goes to the hydrogen. It goes to a chemical process, and they call it a vegetable oil. Deception. And you can ask doctors about the danger. You can ask doctors about the health damage that these products can cause. Ask doctors when we consume. Excessive. So here again, who's causing the corruption of health? Who's creating these pandemics? Who's creating these diseases? Is man, not God. We keep on blaming God, blaming Allah for being sick, blaming Allah for the wars, blaming Allah for everything. But you have to blame man, because the man is the main cause of diseases on earth. ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. That the corruption emerged on earth because of the hands of people, or because of what the hands of people have earned. Not man, not God, is man. Who's making you poor? Who's making people poor? Is man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created a lot of resources, plentiful resources on earth. وَخَلَقَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ فَقَدَّرَهُ تَقْدِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything and determined it with precise determination. Allah has created plentiful resources, mountains of gold, mountains of silver, mountains of minerals, oil, gas, and everything. And this, and behind that also, He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe if there's a mistake, then you can pay your zakah, pay your sadaqah, so there will be no poor person. Rivers, rain, fruits, everything, gardens. But who's making people poor is man, by looking their resources. By his greedy and insatiable desire for wealth. Not Allah. Allah is man who's corrupting the world. As Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said about the avarice and the insatiable desire for everything. He said, إن أول فتنة بني آدم كانت في إن أول فتنة آدم كانت في بطنه وستكون فتنته إلى فتنة ذريته من بعده إلى يوم القيامة. But the first trial of Adam was in his appetite, and it will be the trial of the fitna for his offspring till the day of judgment. Meaning the appetite. When you cannot control your appetite, Ramadan comes to for us to have the self-discipline to control our appetite, to control our desire. If you cannot control your appetite, you cannot control your desire, then you have to know this is one of the fatalities that leads to Jahannam, leads to the hafar, the torment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَ ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا. Those who eat unjustly eat up the wealth, the property of the orphans. They eat up only a fire in their bellies, and they will be burnt in a blazing fire in the day of judgment. So if you cannot control your desire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will control you in the day of judgment. You will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will control your desire in the day of judgment. So also, it's Ramadan comes to break our daily routine. And I was thinking about the taqwa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about fasting the month of Ramadan, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you may attain taqwa. And I was thinking, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mean we attain taqwa. What is the link between fasting and taqwa? And the small example for that is that when we wake up for suhoor, and first thing we do is to rush to the to see the time, to see if you have if you still have more time to have your meal, to have your suhoor. That is taqwa. To see, to rush to the timetable to see if you still have more minutes to have your food, that is taqwa. When you hear the adhan, when you're eating, you hear the adhan of fajr, then you throw out everything, you spit out everything, then you wash your mouth, you brush your teeth, you don't want to leave any food debris in your mouth, you don't want to leave any food that is trapped in your mouth, that is taqwa. When you are performing your wudu, and you make sure that there is no drop of water that you have swallowed, that is taqwa. And if you are in doubt, then you call the mufti, you call the alim, please, is my fasting valid? Is my day valid? That is taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَّا السَّوْمُ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْلِي بِهِ. So, كُلُّ عَمَلِ ابْنِ آدَمَ لَهُ. Every deed of the son of Adam is for him, except for fasting. It is for me, and I shall reward for it because of the taqwa. But yet, this is just part of taqwa. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِزَاهِ حَاجَةً فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَبَهُ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the Authentic Hadith that whosoever or whoever does not abandon the foolish or the false speech, the false speech and the false action, then Allah has no need for him to leave off his food and drink. That means he missed the point. Taqwa encompasses everything. Not that just keeping, you know, keeping yourself hungry and thirsty and you think that you are fasting 100%. No. Wallahi, there are some criminals, really criminal Muslims. When Ramadan arrives, they stop everything. They stopped everything, said no after Ramadan. Although it's not good, you say after Ramadan I will go back to my sins, but at least they respect the month of Ramadan. While we have Muslims don't respect the month of Ramadan. They are the same persons before Ramadan and Ramadan and after Ramadan, the same thing. So they are missing the point. They are really missing the point. If you keep yourself away from you know, depriving yourself from food and drink, but you don't keep yourself away from ghaiba and namima, from gossiping and lying and the false actions, the false deeds, then no need. Why are you fasting then? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that you may attain taqwa, but you are still the same person. So as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَّا الصَّوْمُ فَإِنَّهُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ, except all, every deed of the son of Adam is for him, except for fasting, it is for me, and I shall reward for it. It's like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the angels, the malaika, when they are writing the deeds of the Bani Adam, of the sons of Adam, you know, write 27 degrees for the salah, in jama'ah, write 1 degree for salah alone, write sadaqah, 10 times 10, times 700 times, right, Hajj, it's reward, it's Jannah. But when it comes to fasting, to fast the month of Ramadan, you tell them, hold on, don't write anything. That's for me. Hold on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ. But no person knows what is kept hidden for them of the delightful of us. جَزَاءً لِمَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُونَ, in reward, in compensation of what they were doing. Ramadan also teaches us that despite being deprived of your essential needs, food and drink and sexual desires, despite of being deprived of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compensates you with something better, which is iman. And this reminds us of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, مَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا لِلَّهِ عَوَضَهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِنْ, whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, for Allah's sake, Allah will replace him with something better. Allah tells you, do not touch your food during the day. I will replace you with something better, much more better. Look at the food we have in iftar. Much more, way better than the food we have in normal days. Lunch and dinner and all that. من ترك شيء لله عوضه الله خير منه. This is whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, Allah will bless him with something better. Look at the compassion we have, look at the mercy we have during the month of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah. So what about the compensation of the day of judgment? Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among the people of Jannah. So also Ramadan teaches us something. That فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. But after, undoubtedly, after the hardship comes ease. And we see, we struggle in the morning with no food, with the hunger, with the thirst, with the, we get exhausted. But we know Maghrib is coming. That has to be our methodology in life. Even if you are suffering from problems, disease, whatever, death, whatever, then you have to know that Maghrib is coming, the ease is coming. You see, no Muslim was rushing the Maghrib. Oh, what is Maghrib? No Muslim will do that. Everybody is patient. Everybody is exercising patience because he knows that Maghrib is coming. And we enjoy food. Also, the Nasr of Allah, the help of Allah is coming in our life. As we keep up the keep up fasting, keep up the dua, keep up the good work, keep up salah during the day in Ramadan, we wait for Maghrib with patience. Also, we have to wait for the nasr, for the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our life with patience. فإن مع العسر يسر. Undoubtedly, with hardship comes ease. So we have to relax. So lastly, Laylatul Qadr is coming. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا وغفر الله ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever fasts the month of Ramadan, as we covered this hadith in the past Jumu'ahs, whoever fasts the month of Ramadan out of sincere faith, out of sincere iman, and in pursuit of Allah's reward, then his past sins will be forgiven. And he said, if you miss something during the day, then you have من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا. Whoever makes قيام الليل تراويح تهجد during the nights of Ramadan, then you will have his past sins forgiven. And if you miss these two parts, then you still have another one. من قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever make qiyam during the night of Laylatul Qadr, then Allah will forgive his past sins. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Aisha radiallahu anha, told her in the last days or last 10 days of Ramadan, then you should say this hadith, Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'fu anni. Oh Allah, you are forgiving and you love forgiveness, so forgive me. So please, make most of your dua, this dua. We were busy asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dunya for the whole year. So please, these last 10 days, make most of your dua. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbul afwa fa'fu anni. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives you, then you are successful in this life and in the hereafter. And as we are coming to the last nights and the last days of Ramadan, that gives us an example. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said that it is the example of the last nights of Ramadan. So many Muslims, when so many messages, when they finish the Quran in the 27th night, then so many Muslims will leave. They think that Ramadan is finished. No, Ramadan not finished yet. So Ibn Qayyim gives us an example. He said the racing horses. See, the few meters before the finishing line, they put all their effort to win the race. All their effort in the last yards, the last meters before the finishing line, they put all their effort to win the race. So as has to be the Muslim, don't let the horse to be better than you. The last days, put all your effort. The Ramadan is a guest, so we have to bid farewell to the guest in the proper way. أخذ دعوانا. الحمد لله رب العالمين.